All right, our next speaker is Gary Galo, also a member of the ARSC Technical Committee, speaking on Redbook de-emphasis using the IZOTOPE RX EQ module. Gary retired in 2014 after 38 years as audio engineer at the Crane School of Music, SUNY, SUNY, State University of New York at Potsdam, New York, an active member of ARSC since the 1980s. That's a long time ago, Gary. He has given numerous presentations at ARSC annual conferences, many of which have been published in the ARSC Journal, and has written myriad book and recording reviews for the journal. He's also been a regular presenter at ARSC New York chapter meetings. He was the sound recording review editor of the journal from 1995 to 2012, and co-chair with Seth Winter of the ARSC Technical Committee from 1996 to 2014. He's a member of the Audio Engineering Society, Society of Wilhelm Furtwängler, and the Boston Audio Society. And I would add, Gary, thank you for your many years of service to ARSC. And it's your turn. Take it away.
Okay, let me get my PowerPoint presentation up here. And we'll go full screen. There, I think we have it. Okay, well, thank you all for being here. I know many of you have been around long enough to remember the early days of digital audio, and some of you probably have had hands-on experience making recordings on systems like the Sony PCM-F1, which is now some 40 years old. Transfers of old recordings always involved analog material, and back then most of us couldn't have imagined that we would someday be dealing with transferring obsolete digital recordings to modern standards. But here we are, and last year I gave a presentation on transferring PCM-F1 recordings. Today I'm going to focus on one aspect of early digital recording systems and compact discs, and that is the Redbook pre-emphasis curve and a method for implementing the complementary de-emphasis curve in the digital domain when we transfer and restore these old recordings. Now, before I go on, let me just say there's a lot of technical information and a lot of slides here, and I wouldn't expect anyone to get all of it the first time around. So I'm going to put my email address up on the last slide, and I'll be happy to share a copy of the slideshow as a PDF file with anybody who contacts me. So just let me know, and I'll be happy to send it to you. I'd like to begin with a look at the Redbook specification for pre-emphasis and de-emphasis and the equalization curves that result. Now, as many of you probably know, the so-called Redbook is the book of technical specifications for the compact disc that was developed jointly by Sony and Philips. Now, pre-emphasis was a high-frequency boost that was applied during the record process, and it was ahead of the analog-to-digital converters in early digital recording systems. It was an option in the Sony Philips Redbook for specifications for the compact disc. All of the Denon CDs from the 1980s, Denon is a Japanese company, they all had pre-emphasis, but there are very few other CD manufacturers who actually implemented it. It was also used in some early digital recorders, notably the Sony PCM-F1. And in my presentation last year, I showed how the Tascam DA3000 digital recorder automatically applied de-emphasis. But if you don't use a DA3000 for your transfers, you need an accurate method of dealing with de-emphasis on your computer in the digital domain. Digital recordings and compact discs made with pre-emphasis require a complementary de-emphasis or high-frequency cut during playback. Now, the most common explanation of why pre-emphasis was used on early digital recording systems was that it reduced quantization noise in the early analog-to-digital and digital-to-analog converters. That's certainly true, but noise reduction was probably not the most important benefit. These early converters all also had relatively poor high-frequency linearity at low signal levels, and the treble boost during the record process moved the high frequencies above the region where the linearity of the converters was at its worst. The Redbook pre-emphasis curve is defined by two time constants, 50 microseconds and 15 microseconds, and these correspond to turnover frequencies of 3,183 hertz and 10,610 hertz. The high frequency boost begins at 3183 hertz or 3.183 kilohertz, and it shelves, in other words, it flattens out at 10,610 hertz or 10.61 kilohertz. Most of you, a lot of you will be familiar with the very simple formulas here for converting frequency to time constant and vice versa. You can look at the slideshow again if you've missed those the first time around. Let me say that all of the graphs with black backgrounds and colored traces in this slideshow were created by computer simulations. Now the record boost and shelf shown by the is shown by the green trace in the top graph, and the yellow trace shows the complementary cut that must be applied in playback in order to restore a flat frequency response. Now, pre-emphasis and de-emphasis were applied with analog filters, and all analog filters have phase shift that varies with frequency. Now, back in 2009, I gave an ARSC presentation on phase equalization as it applies to disc recording and playback curves. And I pointed out that when analog filters apply complementary frequency response, complementary phase response is automatic. It comes along for the ride. I published that as an article in the spring 2010 issue of the ARSC journal, if you're interested in having a look at that. Now, this isn't always true of digital filters. They don't always apply the complementary phase response unless they're specifically designed to do so. And I'll get into more of that a little bit later. What the bottom graph shows is the complementary phase responses of the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis filters. The maximum deviation from linear phase is about 32 degrees at around 5,800 hertz. Well, these are very simplified block diagrams of the Sony PCM-F1 recording and playback chains. Basically, on the record end, the analog signal is applied to the analog input. You go through a level control and a buffer amplifier. And then there's an analog filter that creates the pre-emphasis curve. And finally, an anti-aliasing low-pass filter. And from there, we go into the digital domain with analog to digital conversion, digital filtering, and finally storage. And the old PCM-F1 system, like many early digital recording systems, stored the digital audio on videotape, in this case, a Betamax tape. Some of you will remember those. And then in playback on the digital end, we retrieve the data from the storage medium, the beta videotape. We go through digital to analog conversion and digital filtering, and at that point, we're in the analog domain, and there's an analog low-pass filter, the de-emphasis filter network, and a buffer amplifier, and analog out. And the analog pre-emphasis and de-emphasis filters provide the complementary frequency and the complementary phase response. Here are three block diagrams showing the evolution of de-emphasis in CD players. Now in the top diagram on the digital end, we retrieve the data from the compact disc, the storage medium, go through a digital to analog converter, digital filtering. At that point, we're in the analog domain and we go through an analog low-pass filter, a de-emphasis network. Some CD players have level controls, not very many, and if there may be one there. And then there's a buffer amplifier and analog out. Players were designed to detect a pre-emphasis flag on discs that had pre-emphasis, so the de-emphasis would automatically switch in if it was needed. But by the mid-1990s and into the early 2000s, some manufacturers of CD players dispensed with de-emphasis. So the block diagram looks the same as what's above, except the de-emphasis network and the analog end has been eliminated. The reason for this is because very few commercial CDs actually implemented pre-emphasis. Some manufacturers decided to save money by eliminating it. They were no longer in compliance with the Red Book specification, I should add, because they were no longer totally backwards compatible. Now, by the early 2000s, large-scale integration allowed integrated circuit manufacturers to combine digital filtering and digital-to-analog conversion into a single chip. They were typically two separate integrated circuits prior to that. And at that point, many IC manufacturers also began incorporating de-emphasis into these chips and applying it with digital filters. Now, more recently, de-emphasis done digitally has been found in sample rate converter and digital output transmitter chips. So these days, it's almost unheard of to find a player that doesn't do de-emphasis when it's needed. Now, the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves are actually created by combining two curves. And I'd like to take a look at how the de-emphasis playback filters are combined and what happens when we combine them. Now, these filters are the simplest types of analog filters. They are 6 decibel per octave filters, meaning that above or below the turnover frequencies, they attenuate at the rate of 6 dB per octave. So these filters have gradual slopes. They're not brick walls. And so they're not flat right up to the turnover frequency. The turnover frequency is actually the 3 decibel point for a 6 dB per octave, for a 6 dB per octave filter. Now, this is one of the filters we need to create the de-emphasis curve. It's a low pass filter that's 3 decibels down at 3,183 hertz relative to the low end of the frequency spectrum, and it rolls off at 6 dB per octave above that frequency. That's fairly simple. The second filter is a shelf at 10,610 hertz, and relative to the high end of the spectrum, the turnover frequency of 10,610 hertz is at a level of plus 3 dB. So I've shown these two filters separately in the top illustration, and the cursors are basically at the two turnover frequencies. Now in the bottom illustration, it shows the two curves combined to produce the de-emphasis curve. And you might expect that once they're combined, the turnover frequencies are still the 3 dB points, but they're not. And this is very important, and I'm going to have more to say about this later. Now, the two turnover frequencies are fairly close together. So what happens is they interact. Now, I discussed how these types of filters interact in more detail in my presentation on the Columbia LP equalization curve back in 2008, and that was in the ARSC journal in spring 2009. The interactions in phono EQ curves are equally applicable here. Once the curves are combined, 3,183 hertz is actually at minus 2.6 dB relative to the low end of the spectrum, and 10,610 hertz is at plus 2.6 dB relative to the high end of the spectrum. The reason for this is there's simply not enough space between the two turnover points for the slope to ever reach 6 dB per octave. The slope is less than that. Now, this affects something called the Q of the filter, which is very important and which I'm going to talk about more shortly. So in order to verify the accuracy of playback de-emphasis, whether it's applied in the analog or the digital domain, I needed a series of test tones with levels conforming to the pre-emphasis standard. Now, if the playback de-emphasis is accurate, the playback filtering will produce a flat frequency response. I had become frustrated by the fact that there weren't any test CDs with enough individual test tones to measure accuracy. They all had only a handful of tones, which would verify if the de-emphasis worked, but not how accurately it worked. So back in 2007, I decided to take matters into my own hands, and I made a test CD with a large number of test tones, and I created the test tones using SoundForge, which is my main digital editor still. Now, in most of the simulations that follow, I plotted only the frequency response from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, since 20 kilohertz is the upper limit of any of the old formats that use pre-emphasis. They all had low sampling rates. I'll have more to say about that a little bit later as well. So the first step was to run a computer simulation of the Red Book pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves. So this is the pre-emphasis simulation. Now, 6 dB per octave filters normally have one capacitor and one resistor. The two filters we need can be combined into one network with two resistors and a common capacitor. And I've given the formulas here for computing the time constants. The lower time constant, 50 microseconds, is simply the sum of the two resistors times the capacitor. The high time constant, 15 microseconds, is simply the small resistor, R1, times the capacitor. You don't need to worry too much about those formulas. And again, you can look at them again if you ask me for a copy of the slideshow. Now, the resistor and capacitor values I picked here produce a mathematically ideal network, which is necessary for an accurate simulation. Some of you may be wondering what I use for circuit simulation. I still use Circuit Maker 2000 as my schematic drawing and simulation program, which uses a SPICE simulation engine. It has been around for a long time, but it still works really well, and it runs under Windows 10, mercifully. This is the de-emphasis simulation. The network is the same, it's just a different orientation. It's now a shunt network rather than a series network. And the formulas are the same as before. I don't want to get bogged down on these two slides or the circuit diagrams. And if you'd like to look at any of this in more detail, again, you can ask me for a copy of the slideshow. Most circuit simulation programs will allow you to compare the levels between two cursors, which you can move around as you wish. Circuit Maker also will give you a text file with the levels at many more frequencies than you'll ever need for what we're doing here. But from all of this data, I determined the exact levels relative to 20 hertz of all the test tones that I felt I needed for testing. And the chart on the right shows all of that data. You'll notice that in the chart on the right, I only have three tones below 500 hertz. Since pre-emphasis is a high frequency phenomenon, there's virtually no effect on the very low end of the spectrum. So three was all I felt I needed. SoundForge has two useful plugins that I use to create the test tones. The first one is Simple Synthesis, and this allows you to generate several types of waveforms. What we want for this are sine waves, and you can adjust the frequency, the length, and the level of each tone. There's also an FX volume plugin that allows level adjustment to a resolution of a thousandth of a dB. And this level of accuracy is pretty important if we're going to get accurate results when we use this for measurement. So the first thing I did was I created 28 tones between 20 hertz and 20 kilohertz, and I set them all to a level of minus 10 dB. In other words, there's no high frequency pre-emphasis, and this was done using the Simple Synthesis function. The next thing I did is I took those same 28 tones and I adjusted each level to match my pre-emphasis computer simulation, and I did the level adjustments with FX volume. So the left-hand portion of my editing window here are the 28 tones with no pre-emphasis, and the right-hand portion of the editing window are the tones with pre-emphasis applied, again, according to the computer simulation. The 28 tones with pre-emphasis are the ones we need for de-emphasis testing. So here they are once again. Okay, so now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of this presentation, and that is how to do digital equalization correction and how to measure its accuracy. There's quite a bit of what we're going to cover here that illustrates the steps I took along the way to get to my final results. But these steps along the way, I think, are broadly applicable to using digital equalizers, particularly the ones in IZOTOPE RX and Ozone, for other applications, including phono equalization and tape equalization. So you can apply a lot of what we're going to cover here to other things which you'll need in audio. Now, digital de-emphasis is applied using a high shelf filter, and there are three settings that we need to consider. The first one is gain. What we need to do is measure the total level difference between the lowest and the highest frequencies. In this case, 20 hertz and 20 kilohertz. You'll see I have cursors on the outside. At least 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz is what I thought at first, so we're going to go with that for a bit. The level difference between those two frequencies is 9.49 dB. So the midpoint gain is 4.7, is half of that difference, or 4.75 dB. And the midpoint gain is what's important here for our gain levels or level setting. So the next thing we need to do is locate the frequency at which the level is at that midpoint of 4.75 dB. And the computer simulation shows that the frequency is 5,245 hertz. The last setting is Q, which can be a sticky topic when it comes to filter design, but we'll keep it simple. Q stands for quality factor. And in simple terms, the lower the Q, the more gradual the roll-off, like what you see on the left. The higher the Q, the steeper the roll-off, like you see on the right. These screen captures are of the IZOTOPE RX equalization module's high shelf filter. And we'll see a lot more of that in a bit. So a very gradual slope, low Q, a steeper slope, high Q. Now the Q settings for 6 dB per octave filters should be 0.707. This graph shows the two turnover points, again, 3,183 and 10,610 hertz. Now, if you used SoundForge versions 10 and 11, you may remember that they came with an IZOTOPE plugin called Mastering Equalization. Mastering EQ had presets for the Redbook pre-emphasis curve and what they called the post-emphasis curve. Now, IZOTOPE's post-emphasis settings were a mid-frequency of 5,225 hertz, a level of 4.7 dB, and a Q of 7.00. Now, how they arrived at this Q setting is a mystery to me, but they offered no explanation about the type of filter emulation they were doing. You will notice that in the third column, it's actually labeled Q slash slope, but 7.00 doesn't seem right for either of these. Now, IZOTOPE seems to have arrived at their frequency and level settings based on a bandwidth of 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, but they were a little sloppy, and I'm going to examine that more closely shortly. So using the test tones that I created for pre-emphasis, I checked the accuracy of the IZOTOPE Mastering EQ preset using the SoundForge statistics function. The first thing I did is I ran the Mastering EQ preset on the series of test tones. And then I simply highlighted about half of each tone in the middle and I noted the level. Now in this case, maximum sample value is what you want. I've shown it by the red arrow in the old SoundForge statistics window. Then I put the results into an Excel spreadsheet. The first thing I did was I entered the decibel measurements I got from SoundForge's statistics. That's the middle column in this spreadsheet. And then I added 10 decibels to each to put the 20 hertz reference at 0 dB. And this gives the results in the fourth column. The spreadsheet then gives the results in the fourth column, right? And the spreadsheet then calculates the total deviation from 0 dB, or a perfectly flat response, and divides that by 2 to give us an accuracy in plus or minus so many decibels. That's all shown in the right column, highlighted in red. So then I take those results and I plot them on an Excel graph. And the accuracy of the IZOTOPE Mastering EQ preset is plus or minus 0.43 dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. That's not real great. Now, when we design RIAA phono playback equalizers and high performance phono preamps, we try to get the accuracy much better than that. The best RIAA phono preamps often measure plus or minus a tenth of a dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Now, some of you may think that that's overkill, but it has been shown that the human ear can detect very small deviations from a flat frequency response playing program material because the nature of equalization errors is such that they're spread over two or more octaves. They're not just confined to a single frequency, and music doesn't consist of individual test tones. Well, so much for the old IZOTOPE Mastering EQ program, which hasn't been available for about 10 years anyway. So let's move on to the IZOTOPE RX equalization module, beginning with some initial preparation. I did all of this in RX 7 advanced originally. I now have RX 9, but the equalization settings and the EQ window are exactly the same. So the first thing we do is select the default setting. Next thing we need to do is select the analog filter emulation in the upper left and the high shelf filter in the lower left. Now you need to turn off 5 out of the 6 bands. I turned off band 1 through 5 and used band 6 only. And we can save this as a template that you can go back to and modify as you wish. Now, I mentioned the complementary phase responses of the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves a little earlier. And as I mentioned earlier, complementary analog filters automatically provide complementary phase equalization. Now the RX EQ module's analog filter setting creates what we call infinite impulse response, or IIR, minimum phase filters, which they note in their online help and in their product descriptions. Now this is exactly what we need to duplicate the phase response of analog filters, and that's very good news. So now we take those test tones and we open them up in IZOTOPE RX. Now you want the waveform display only. You can turn off the spectral display. It'll just confuse the issue. So the next thing we do is we set the frequency, the gain, and the Q. Now, rather than using IZOTOPE's old mastering EQ settings as the basis for my first attempt in RX EQ, I set the gain and the frequency according to my own computer simulation. And my computer simulation from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz showed that IZOTOPE miscalculated the level and the center frequency in their old mastering EQ plugin. My simulation showed that the mid-frequency point is 5,245 hertz with a midpoint gain of 4.75 dB. I have a feeling what they did is they rounded off the midpoint gain to 4.7 dB. And then when they tried to find the mid-frequency, that was wrong as well. That's my guess as to what happened. Now I set the Q to 0.707, which should be right for 6 dB per octave analog filters. Now let me mention that the RX equalization module will allow you to enter up to 2 decimal places in the gain and the Q settings. The display will round them off, but if you click on them again, you'll see that the settings you entered have been retained. Now I entered minus 4.75 dB for the gain, which the display rounded up to minus 4.8. I entered 0.707 for the Q. The program rounded up to 0.71 and the display reads 0.7. You can save these settings using the pull-down menu at the top. So the next thing to do was to run those settings on the entire file, and you can easily see that the response is not perfectly flat. There's a hump around 3 kilohertz. Next, I used RX's waveform statistics to measure each frequency. You open up the waveform statistics and highlight about half of each tone in the middle. This is a close-up look at the RX waveform statistics module. Now, since the test tones are sine waves, sample peak, maximum RMS, minimum RMS, and total RMS are normally the same. You can take your pick. And then we insert the results into an Excel spreadsheet, just like before. And finally, plot the results on an Excel graph. This one's not very good. It's actually worse than the results I got with IZOTOPE's old mastering EQ, plus or minus a half a dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So the next question is, what's wrong with the settings I use? Well, what went wrong is really pretty simple. I made the same mistake that IZOTOPE made with their mastering EQ, and here's what's going on. At 20 kilohertz, the shelf is still falling in level. It hasn't reached its final level. So the simulation from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz isn't wide enough. That's the top graph. So I expanded the simulation from 1 hertz to 100 kilohertz, and that's the bottom graph. The expansion on the top end of the spectrum is what's really important here. Expanding it on the bottom isn't of much consequence, but I did it anyway. So let me say at this point that I realize that there are formulas for calculating some of the parameters, but in the end, I found that I was just as well off, if not better off, following my computer simulations. So the expanded frequency response simulation now gives us new settings. The midpoint gain between 1 hertz and 100 kilohertz is now minus 5.2 dB, and that level occurs at a frequency of 5,780 hertz. Now, it's no coincidence that the midpoint frequency is also the point of maximum phase deviation. You may remember earlier that I said it was around 5,800 hertz. You can see that my initial values of minus 4.75 dB and 5,245 hertz were pretty far off. Now, I also had to readjust the Q. And this goes back to what I said earlier when I showed how the two corner frequencies are no longer the 3 dB points. When the low pass filter and the shelf are combined, they're now the 2.6 dB points. And because the two turnover frequencies are fairly close together, the downward slope never reaches 6 dB per octave. It's shallower than that. And because the slope is less than 6 dB per octave, we have to use a lower Q setting in our IZOTOPE EQ module in order to duplicate it. And I found that I found the optimum value by simply running a few trials with RX equalization. So the Q is now 0.5, it's not 0.707. So here are the final EQ settings that I came up with. I ran the EQ settings on the test tones and I plotted the results in Excel. I'll put the final settings up again on the last slide. They're also in the next slide. You can write them down if you like. So here is the final Excel graph, and now we've got it. The accuracy is now plus or minus 25 thousandths of a dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. And that's pretty close to ruler flat response. I doubt that any Red Book de-emphasis method will get much better than this. Again, thanks for bearing with me as I went through the various steps in the evolution that led to the final results. I think this is useful in developing other applications for the RX EQ module, like phono equalization and tape equalization and so forth. The last thing I'd like to talk about is phase correction. Now, a 32 degree error around 5.8 kilohertz isn't terrible. It's certainly not even close to the phase distortion that must be corrected in an RIAA phono preamp, which occurs across the entire audible spectrum. But since the RX equalization module has an analog simulation, an accurate de-emphasis curve should also correct the phase shift in the pre-emphasis curve. The question is how to verify the phase correction. Some of you may remember this Denon test CD from 1984. It was one of the most useful test CDs made at the time. And it included 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz frequency sweeps with pre-emphasis off and pre-emphasis on. Now this didn't have individual tones, so it wasn't particularly useful for the testing that I wanted to do at the time on various players. They were continuous sweeps. But for this test, they'll be quite useful to us. So I extracted those tracks from the CD. And using SoundForge, I put the sweep with pre-emphasis in the left channel and the sweep without pre-emphasis on the right. And then I carefully aligned the channels at the beginning of the sweeps and I saved the file. Then in IZOTOPE RX, I ran EQ on the left channel using my final settings and I saved that file. Now, because IZOTOPE RX doesn't have a phase scope, I had to go back into SoundForge to play the file, which I did. And I watched the phase scope across the entire 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz spectrum. And the Lissajous display on the scope showed excellent phase response across the entire spectrum. The whole file is only 50 seconds long, so it doesn't take very long to play it. And watch it. What I wanted to do was zero in on the phase correction at the center frequency of 5,780 hertz. And I did this using Adobe Audition. I zeroed in on the center frequency, again, 5780, where the phase shifts in the filters are at maximum. Now, the Adobe Audition phase scope has an interesting feature that I've never seen in any other phase scope. It allows you to drop the cursor at any point in the file without actually playing the file. So you can see the phase display at any instant in time. Very handy feature that I've used for many conference presentations. As you can see, the phase correction at the center frequency is excellent. Some of you are probably wondering if you can use ozone for this, and yes, indeed you can. What they call the HUD or heads up display won't allow you to set the Q to less than one. So you have to select the all bands view, which I've indicated with a red arrow. It looks like a little globe. Ozone's analog filter emulation is also an IIR minimum phase filter, just like RX. Again, very good news. Some of you are probably wondering if these equalization differences in de-emphasis or these differences in de-emphasis equalization are audible. So let's see if we can find out. How much you'll be able to hear will depend on your internet connection and also whatever computer audio setup you have. This is the second movement of Mahler's Fifth Symphony from the excellent Mahler cycle with Eliyahu Inbal and the Frankfurt Radio Orchestra. It was recorded by Denon back in the 1980s. And as I mentioned earlier, all Denon CDs from this period had pre-emphasis. We'll hear the first minute or so of this movement. First, the original raw CD extraction without any de-emphasis. You won't have any problem hearing that. It sounds pretty bright. Second, we'll play the same excerpt with de-emphasis applied with the old IZOTOPE mastering EQ program. And finally, with my IZOTOPE RX EQ settings.
Gary, I don't think we can hear the sound. We're getting some reports that the sound's not coming through. Could you try resharing again? And just make sure that share audio button is on.
Okay. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
So where do I find that?
You'll have to unshare the screen at the top, click stop sharing, and then share again.
Oh, so I have to stop the share. Will you be able to see the slideshow?
Yes, reshare the slides and click share sound. When you click the share screen button, there's a share sound checkbox in the bottom left.
Oh, okay. I get it. Okay. All right.
That should do the trick.
Okay. Let me. Okay. We're right back there. Okay. Let's see if this works. I need to unmute my microphone or mute.
You got it working now. That's great.
Hey, Gary, thank you very much. Any more you want to ask before we go on to Q&A?
My mic was not unmuted. I've got to cover this last slide here.
Okay, no problem. Okay.
There are other obvious applications for digital filtering, and for me, the obvious one is phonoequalization, which also requires infinite impulse response minimum phase filters, but you'll need to use ozone for this. Now, I've done some experimenting creating photo EQ curves with ozone, and that may be a good topic for next year. But this brings me to a few complaints that I have about IZOTOPE RX. First, there's no 6 dB per octave low pass and high pass filters in the RX equalization module. You need a 6 dB per octave low pass filter to create the treble roll off for phono EQ curves. You can do this in ozone. The other thing is that there's no phase scope in RX and no crossfade ability in RX. Those two things, I think, are something that any digital editor should have. I don't really think of RX as an editor. I think of it as an audio restoration toolbox, and as such, it's an excellent program. The lack of crossfade ability is one of the main reasons I won't use it as an editor. I still use SoundForge for all of my editing. If you agree with any of this, contact IZOTOPE and let them know. So here are the... There we go. Here are the final RX EQ settings again, in case you didn't get them all before. And if you'd like a copy of the slideshow as a PDF file, just drop me an email and I'll be happy to send it to you.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Gary.
Thank you.
We have one question to start with, and we'll see what shows up here. Gary, have you compared the accuracy of pre-emphasis detection in various CD ripping software programs? Do you have a preferred ripping software that is more accurate than others?
I haven't done that. I'm not sure which ripping programs actually automatically detect de-emphasis. If I need to rip a CD, one of the things SoundForge has, which RX doesn't have, SoundForge allows you to extract audio from a CD. So I will just extract the audio from a CD in SoundForge. SoundForge automatically puts markers in where all the tracks are. And then I'll run my equalization plugin to take care of the de-emphasis.
What version of SoundForge are you using, by the way?
I have 12 and 15. They just introduced 16. I bought 15, the upgrade, and found that I had one glitch. It's got some glitches running VST plugins. One of the nice things about IZOTOPE RX and SoundForge, at least my SoundForge 12, is that they integrate pretty nicely. When you buy IZOTOPE RX Standard or Advanced, it comes with a VST plugin called RX Connect. When you're in SoundForge, if you hear something or see something that you think needs fixing, you can highlight it in the editing window, click on RX Connect, send it over to IZOTOPE RX, fix it, and then send it back into SoundForge, and it'll automatically put it back where it belongs. There's a glitch in SoundForge 15. It doesn't work right. I can send it over, but I can't get it back.
I'm still using 12. No, please. You're still using 12.
12, yeah.
Okay. Richard Hess suggested DB Power Amp, which is widely used, as well as EAC, which is Exact Audio Copy.
I have DB Power Amp. Yeah, it's a good program.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. All right, any other questions, please feel free to drop them in the Q&A box. In the meantime, if Nick is still around, I would open it also to questions for Nick so that we can address. We were kind of quick at the end of his talk, if there are any others. And so if you have any questions for either Gary or for Nick, please feel free to ask away. And Nick, do you have any comments, anything you'd like to add at this point? You're muted, Nick.
I think Gary, you'd mentioned that it didn't work for doing phono EQ. What was the issue you encountered?
Okay, it didn't. You mean you're talking with SoundForge?
No. With the RX that you were doing with the digital.
RX, the high and low pass filters and the RX EQ module, 12 dB per octave is the gentlest slope it will do. They won't do per octave roll-offs. And the thing is, what's ridiculous about this is that since they have designed 6 dB per octave filters for ozone, why can't they put them into RX? It can't be that big a deal. And by the way, you can run ozone because it's a VST plugin. You can run it as a VST plugin within IZOTOPE RX. Mm-hmm. And ozone elements, the cheapest version, does have the EQ module with everything you need to do this.
Mm. You had mentioned the 7Q in the old module. I remember that from the Waves plugins too. Some of the Waves EQs, you know, list their kind of a Q as of one as the is that number for some reason.
Yeah. Yeah, I have, like I said, I have no idea where they came up with that number of 7.
Mm-hmm. Well, gentlemen, we're up. Here we go. What differences for Gary? What differences do you hear in the samples with the old and new de-emphasis EQs?
On my computer audio system, which is a pretty good one, I can hear that little peak at 3 kilohertz, and I brought my wife down when I finally got my final one done and I was preparing this slideshow. I brought her down to listen to them too, and we both agreed there's just a slight little upper mid-range edge in that old IZOTOPE module. You can hear that little peak at 3 kilohertz, and whereas the final settings that I got, it says there's a bit of smoothness there that's not in the IZOTOPE play in the IZOTOPE old EQ module. Just that upper mid-range smoothness is a little bit better.
Mm-hmm.
We both agreed when we heard the final setting I did compared to the old IZOTOPE mastering EQ plugin that yes, this sounds like an orchestra.
Hmm. Gary, we're waiting for a few more, but I would ask you about the F1 system for a minute, since you spoke about that a couple of years ago at one of the previous conferences. And any updates from F1 that you'd want to share with us in the meantime?
No, none that I can think of. No.
Okay. All right. Richard Hess just basically said, "Yep, I heard that here." So there you go.
It depends on your internet connection and how good your computer audio system is. So I'm glad he was able to hear that. And by the way, Richard and I have had a little bit of correspondence about phono EQ curves too, or I mean tape EQ curves too, because of course that's something he's very interested in. So we'll be pursuing all of this within the next year.
Yeah, he mentioned that yesterday during the workshop. So sounds like the two of you have been in touch. All right, question for Nick, and forgive me if I understand the process. Would a reference disc used for final approval for release have been played back with the ideal playback curve applied?
So it depended on the system. So I mean, one of the nice things about the broadcast systems is they took the EQ pretty seriously. So, you know, because they were for always in professional studios, the record and playback EQ were both complicated, but they were the complete inverse. And so in those situations, yes, you know, they would be very close. You know, with the commercial music recordings, you know, they would typically be checking things on a more typical playback system, like a home system. And so at that point, you know, it's not exactly. I think they would have had the ability to check it, you know, pretty close, but they would always probably be checking for the home consumer as well.
Thank you. Gary, did you have something to add?
Could I make a comment about something sure. Nick touched upon earlier in his presentation? Nick, you showed a graph of microphone peaks in some of the early microphones used for electrical recording. And back in 1996, the first time we were in Kansas City, I gave a paper on disc recording equalization. And I had one or two people in the audience tell me they were insistent that microphone response was part of the phono equalization curve, the record equalization curve. And I was pretty insistent that it was not. And when I was finally preparing that paper for publication in the journal, I got a very, very valuable document from Doug Pomeroy. I think many of us have gotten many valuable pieces of information from Doug Pomeroy. He sent me a letter from 1935 from E.C. Foreman, who was an engineer at RCA Victor. And Foreman's view was, this was in response to a customer writing him a letter and asking about what constitutes the correct playback curve, and do you have to take into consideration what the microphone sounded like and like that. Mm-hmm. Foreman gave what was Victor's official position at that time, and that was basically that the record equalization is the cutter and its associated electronics. And yes, there may be other factors like room acoustics, microphone response, and whatever that you may want to correct, but that's not part of the disc recording equalization curve. That was that was Victor's official position, which I happen to agree with.
Yeah, it gets a little touchy there in the mid-30s because they were using a pretty significant boost on the ribbon microphones, the preamps that went with them. And so the interesting thing that kind of complicates it is they say, you know, when that that kind of official a lateral EQ thing came out, they seem to imply to, you know, turn that EQ off in the microphone preamplifiers. So there must have been some kind of, you know, conversion there a little bit, you know, between the kind of, you know, like the mid-30s and the late-30s when they were doing this conversion. I'm not sure.
Yeah, you're right about that. In fact, in my 1996 paper, I mentioned that. And I think I quoted an article from somebody named Moyer, who talked about the fact that when they started using ribbon microphones, they missed that little punch in the top that the condenser microphone resonances gave them. And Moyer mentioned that they were giving it a boost, which he called voice effort equalization, to give it that same punch that people were missing from the ribbon mics.
We have one further question from Melissa Wodzinski. Have you all considered writing a plugin for specific and accurate disc EQs?
Well, this is something I want to work on in the next year or so with the ozone module. I want to come up with a dozen or so different bass turnover frequencies and low bass shelves and a dozen or so treble roll-offs that can be used. Yeah, that's my next step, is to apply
there
this.
There are a couple of EQs out there. You know, unfortunately, ARSC doesn't have one, or, you know, the typical ones here, but the NOAA platform, I believe, you can type in the microseconds and it'll, you know, you can duplicate a curve that way. And I think also the CubeTech they have a plugin that will take things in microseconds. Yeah.
RX does, do they have a plugin that will run in under RX?
No, I don't think so, no. Yeah, okay. So you have to be on their platforms is the problem.
I want to come up with some settings that you can use in ozone and run it within RX and do it that way.
Mm. Yeah, interesting to note both NOAA and CubeTech are European companies too. Wonder if anything's been a brewing in the United States. So just some words for thought.
It doesn't seem like it would be that difficult for IZOTOPE to do. So it'd be great if they did it at some point.
No, it shouldn't be that hard. I just need to go back to my old computer simulations I did for my archival phono preamp and come up with settings in RX that duplicate them.
Yeah. Gary, by the way, make sure you look at chat. The requests for your PDF, your presentation are already rolling in, and I imagine you might get some more. So make sure you take that down. And we're right at quitting time, folks. So perfect timing. Thanks so much to both of you. Thanks to our audience for listening in and asking such great questions. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. Don't forget, ask the TC tonight at 7 o'clock, 7 to 9. Nick is on that panel along with Jessica Thompson, Eric Jacobs, and Melissa Wodzinski. A great chance for free to get answers to a lot of your own personal questions. Y'all take care. We'll see you again soon. Take care. Bye-bye.